on that rock.
Thank you.
Precious blood. Oh God, thank you for that blood that you shed. Your blood was more than enough, oh God. More than enough for me. Lord, I say thank you, Lord. will not trample on that blood of Jesus. I will not put my trust in another, oh God. You are mighty Savior. You took my place that day. Blood. There's power in the blood. Power in the blood of Jesus.
Well, for a number of weeks we've been dealing with the scripture in Galatians 5:1. We never got very far with it, but we'll keep at it and we'll get there. Praise God. Stand fast, therefore, in the liberty wherewith Christ has set us free, and be not entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Amen. Amen. Who's to stand fast? We are, because we are in Christ. And how are we going to stand fast? Refuse to be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. Refuse to be tied with religious systems that's all around us. Over the last few weeks, we have proved from the Word of God that the baptism of the Holy Spirit is a totally different experience from being born again of the Spirit of God. We have established from the Word of God that tongues is the Bible evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. There's people today and they're saying that tongues are not necessary. You can be filled with the Spirit without speaking in tongues. There's a confusion there of sanctification. Sanctification has been set apart for God, which happens at salvation. And we need the baptism of the Holy Spirit to grow in that sanctification, to grow in a life that's set apart for God. So we're going to read from 1 Corinthians 12 about the spiritual gifts. The devil doesn't like the spiritual gifts. But that doesn't matter to us. We're not worried about what he likes. I don't care what the devil's going to do. We've got the Word. We've got faith. We've got a loving Christ. We've got a Holy Spirit that leads us continually. 1 Corinthians 12, verse 1, now concerning spiritual gifts, brethren, I would not have you to be ignorant. In other words, I want you to understand the spiritual gifts. And we want to say at this point, the spiritual gift for all those that are baptized in the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in tongues, because that's the Bible evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit. You know that you were Gentiles carried away unto these dumb idols, even as you were led. The Corinthian church is a Gentile church. There was a lot of idolatry, a lot of nonsense going on in their territory. And we see a picture of the Corinthian church similar to what we see today. We have many churches in our land today, and they're continuing on. They've come out of idolatry, partly. But they've brought some of the idolatry with them. In other words, when we bring idolatry, we bring bondage. And we're to stand fast in the liberty wherewith Christ has set us free, and not be entangled again with the yoke of bondage. To refuse to walk away from a doctrine that is not based on the Word of God is idolatry. And this last move of the Spirit of God in the last days, we read about it last week. It was all in the Word. It was all there. It was written from the Bible and not the Beano. And all the signs that will be in the last move of the Spirit of God in these days, whenever the gospel of the kingdom has been preached in all the earth, and then the end shall come. So we need the gifts of the Holy Spirit in operation. And he's saying here, you know how you were Gentiles before you were saved, and you were led about with idolatry and all the nonsense of the day. Wherefore I give you to understand that no man speaking by the Spirit of God causes Jesus accursed, and that no man can say that Jesus is Lord but by the Holy Spirit. That's not just speaking words. That's believing it. That's living it. And whenever we're speaking under the unction of the Holy Spirit, we will not be calling Jesus accursed. We will be glorifying his name. We'll be glorifying his church. Now there are diversities of gifts, but the same Spirit. The apostle is dealing with the problem here, not of the gifts of the Spirit, but on how they operate them. How they are trying to appear bigger than each other because they've got more gifts or operated in a better way. He's not doing away with the gifts. He's trying to get them into line. And we've got to go through 12, 13, and 14 chapters to get it right. To get it into context. So there's many gifts, but there's one Spirit, and that's the Holy Spirit. These are the gifts of the Holy Spirit to the church. We have the gift of the Father, which is Jesus. We have the gift of Jesus to his church, which is the fivefold ministry, Ephesians 4. Here we're reading about the gifts of the Spirit. And Jesus will say nothing that doesn't glorify Jesus. He will say nothing that he hasn't heard Jesus and the Father talk about. So the genuine gifts of the Spirit of God are to glorify Jesus Christ. The genuine gifts of the Holy Spirit are to bring the people of God into unity, and we just serve each other. We're not trying to be bigger than each other. We're just walking together. We're a family living together and growing together. And when we grow together, then we'll glow together. And that is the light that our sister had been talking about in her vision today. We got to grow and glow in the presence of God and in the Word of God. And there are diversities of operations. And we must have verse there. And there are differences of administration, but the same Lord. There are diversities of operations, but it is the same God which worketh all in all. But the manifestation of the Spirit is given to every man to profit with all. Why does the devil try to remove the gifts of the Spirit in this world today? He doesn't want us to be profiting in God. He doesn't want us to be profiting in the water walk with God. And it says here, it's to profit with all. For to one is given by the Spirit the word of wisdom. Why do we need the gift of the word of wisdom? Without going into it in great depth and a lot of time, The word of wisdom is something, as a gift that God gives to several as he will. Like, we're not tied to one gift. It is when we're facing a problem, we will have that word of wisdom in our spirit that will unlock that problem. Remember being called into a situation one day where a woman from Africa, a Buddhist, she repented of Buddhism, but she didn't become a Christian, she became a religious person. She joined a church that calls itself Christian, but it's not Christian, it's idolatry. And this party was trying to see her delivered from different things. And it was like a block wall. I was cutting the lawn and I was sweating, I was smelly. When I got the phone call, could I come and see what the problem was? But on my way to that home, I had the word of knowledge, the word of wisdom. The problem was, she's not a Christian. She didn't turn to Christianity, she turned to religious system. So I got there and with great difficulty persuaded the people that were ministering, because they sort of got up in the attitude that I was trying to make them out stupid. I'm only telling what the Lord told me. But when they calmed down and got their act together, they found out what I told them was correct. And when she repented of joining that religious organization and gave her life to Jesus, repented and called upon the name of Jesus, we pulled a chain up out of her blouse and there was a crucifix on it. We will not be liberated by a dead Christ. But when she called upon the name of the Lord, she was delivered. She left that home that day, a free woman. Because whoever Jesus sets free is free indeed. That's a word of wisdom, unlocking a problem. You think the devil wants us to unlock problems that he has caused in the first place? Don't think so. So the word of wisdom is the first gift spoken, and that's only an example. It works in many different ways. To another, the word of knowledge by the same Spirit. What is the word of knowledge? Word of knowledge is whenever we get a word of knowledge about somebody that's got a problem or they're suffering from a sickness or a disease. They've got pain. And sometimes we feel the pain. That's the word of knowledge. Through the word of knowledge, many people get healed and set free. To another, faith. The gift of faith is a purple gift. Because not only is faith a fruit of the Spirit, it's a gift. And when we get that gift of faith, it lifts us beyond the level that we're used walking on. We can move onto a greater realm of the supernatural. Because that gift has raised our faith to a different level. To another, the gift, notice gifts, not gift this time. It's the gifts of healing by the same Spirit. If you know how some people are more used in particular illnesses and sicknesses than other people, that's the gifts of healing. Many different gifts. Some may have a greater track record with cancers, and some other people have a great track record with bone problems and so on. That's the gifts of healing. Not to be confused with the commission to the church. for these signs shall follow them that believe. We're not talking about the commission, we're talking about the gifts. And it's a confusion about the gifts that brings the doctrines that are hindering our land today. To another, the working of miracles. And that's just an extension of what we've already talked about. People will change circumstances. The gift of miracles enables people to change circumstances. To another, prophecy. Somebody got the gift of prophecy, it doesn't make them a prophet. Again, a great confusion lies between the gift of prophecy and the office of prophecy. But there is the gift of prophecy. To another, the discerning of spirits. Discernment that when we're praying for people, we know exactly what spirit or what demon we're dealing with. That's the discerning of spirits. It develops onto the level when we hear somebody proclaiming what they call the Word of God. And it's really not. We will discern the spirit that's behind that sermon. We will discern the spirit that's behind that message. We'll know whether it's of God or not. To another, diverse kinds of tongues. Again, a confusion arises in some of the doctrines we hear today because they can't discern between the heavenly language that comes at the baptism of the Holy Spirit and the gift of tongues are totally different. And that's where a lot of confusion is coming in. This is the gift of diverse kinds of tongues, to another, the interpretation of tongues. It's important that we understand that we are talking here about gifts of tongues and not the Bible evidence of speaking in tongues at the baptism, because it's confusion that people have brought about because of their misunderstanding of these things. Tongues and interpretation of tongues equals prophecy. And when we continue on through chapter 12, 13, and 14, it's important that we remember that. Tongues, interpretation is the same as the gift of prophecy when the two are operated together. But all these worketh that one and the selfsame Spirit, dividing to every man several as he will. As we seek the gifts of the Spirit, it'll be the Father's will which ones we walk on, which ones we minister on. For as the body is one and hath many members, and all the members of that one body being many are one body, so also is Christ. When we remember that we are all part of the one body of Christ, we will not yield to the temptation to try to make ourselves bigger or better than anybody else, but we will use the gifts of the Spirit that we are given. Use is not a good word. To operate in the gifts of the Spirit that we have been given, it is to bring unity into the body of Christ. It's to bring clarity to the body of Christ what the devil's trying to do against our brothers and our sisters. So if we begin to walk in that unity and the gifts of the Spirit in operation, for by one Spirit we are all baptized into one body, whether we be Jew or Gentile, whether we be bond or free, have been all made to drink into one Spirit. Talking there, that's to do with the day that they were in, because they were slaves in those days and they were bond. And they're free people. Not to do with anything else at this stage. For the body is not one member but many. If the foot shall say, because I am not the hand, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? Should somebody operate on the gift of wisdom, or the gift of knowledge, or the gift of faith, try to make his brother and sister to feel that they're not necessary? You see, this is where disunity can come in. We are all necessary to the functioning of the body of Christ. We're all different. We've all got different gifts. But we're all necessary. God's no respecter of persons. God doesn't love one more than he loves the other. And we shouldn't love one brother more than we love another brother or sister, whatever the case may be. And if the ear shall say, because I am not the eye, I am not of the body, is it therefore not of the body? If the whole body were an eye, where were the hearing? If the whole were hearing, where were the smelling? But now hath God set the members, every one of them, in the body as it has pleased him. Don't feel intimidated with somebody else's ministry, because you are where Jesus put you, where God put you, because it pleased him. Where you are in the body of Christ is pleasing of the Father, because that's his will. That's where he put us. Yes, we're to covet earnestly the best gifts. They're all good, so how do you pick best out of good? We covet earnestly the best gift that equips us to fulfill the ministry that God has called us unto. You see, we read over these things, we don't think about them. So God has set us where it pleases him. If we were all one member, where were the body? Now are they many members, yet but one body. And the eye cannot say unto the hand, I have no need of thee, nor again to the head, or to the feet, I have no need of you. Nay, much more, those members of the body which seem to be more feeble are necessary. So if the devil's telling you you're too weak, you're not much good to the body of Christ, the word of God saying different here, you're very necessary. It doesn't say people that are feeble. Verse 22, nay, much more those members of the body which seem to be more feeble. Not more feeble, but seem to be more feeble. How the devil wraps the thoughts. So you see, when we renew our mind in Christ, when we take on that mind of Christ, we will not allow the devil to make us feel more feeble. But the Word of God said they're all necessary. Even in that state of the devil making us feel, who are we, what am I? God said to us, we are necessary. Every one of us that are born again of the Spirit of God are necessary. So never let the devil make you feel like a doormat. Jesus, in the Word here, is saying, all necessary. And those members of the body which we think to be less honorable, upon these we bestow more abundant honor, and our uncomely parts have more abundant comeliness. For our comely parts have no need, but God hath retempered the body together, having given more abundant honor to that part which lacked. That there should be no schism in the body, but that the members should have the same care one for another. the way to keep the schism out of the body, the way to keep disunity out of the body is honoring and preparing one another before ourselves. Loving one another. Somebody wrote a song one time, if you don't love your brother, you can't love God. Because if we don't love God, we can't love anybody else. Not in the sense that the Word of God's talking about. And whether one member suffer, all members suffer with it. Or one member be honored, all members rejoice with it. Now ye are the body of Christ. Ye are the body of Christ. You're not going to be the body of Christ. Ye are the body of Christ. We're all in Christ. If any man be in Christ, he's a new creature. All things have passed away. Behold, all has become new. And God has set some in the church. First apostles, secondary prophets, thirdly teachers. After that, miracles, then gifts of healing, helps, governments, diversities of tongues. Are all apostles? That's asking the question. No, all are not apostles. Are all prophets? No, all are not prophets. Many will prophesy through the gifts, but they're not prophets. Are all teachers? No, they're not all teachers. Are all workers of miracles? That's not linked to the Great Commission, that these signs shall follow them that believe. People will have a greater ministry and some type of miracles. Have all the gifts of healing. Everybody will not have the gifts of healing, but they can still see the sick healed because of the commission. You know, the majority of people that I talk to out of denominations that don't believe in the baptism of the Holy Spirit are praying for the sick. They don't give me scripture for their attitude. They give me a version of their testimony. I used to do that, nobody got healed, so I just stopped. Devil loves an answer like that. If we haven't got scripture for our attitude and our ministry and our actions, we're stooping very low whenever we're just saying, well, God didn't answer prayers, so I just stopped praying. A pastor one night had preached a sermon on blind Bartimaeus. He never once mentioned that Bartimaeus was physically blind. He was preaching on spiritual blindness. I don't have a problem with that. But during a cup of tea afterwards, I asked him, how come you never mentioned that Bartimaeus was spiritually blind or physically blind? Well, he said, I used to preach that and nobody ever got healed. So I just stopped preaching it. I said, well, you've got a great problem for next Sunday. He said, how come? I said, well, you preach salvation tonight, nobody got saved. So if that's your attitude, what are you going to preach next week? That's a number of years. I'm still waiting on the answer. We preach the gospel of the kingdom because it's the command of the Lord Jesus Christ. We stand on this gospel of the kingdom because it's the word of the living God. And then they latch on to verse 30, have all the gifts of healing. No, everybody doesn't have the gifts of healing. Only as many as the Lord give, but it doesn't hinder them from praying for the sick because of the commission of the church. Do you all speak with tongues? The answer here is no, because it's talking about the gifts, the gift of tongues. But they interpret that that you can't say that the Bible evidence of the baptism of the Holy Spirit is speaking in tongues when the Bible says everybody doesn't speak with tongues. That's not what the Bible's saying. The Bible's saying not everyone will have the gift of tongues. Totally different. But the devil latches on there. Do you all interpret? No, that's a gift that some people have and some people don't. But covet earnestly the best gifts. Notice covet earnestly the best gift, because the great deception that occurs here, it goes on to say, yet show I unto you a more excellent way. And there's many people today and they believe that the more excellent way that 13 talks about, chapter 13 talks about, is the love replacing the gifts of the Spirit. That is a deception. So why would he say, seek earnestly the best gifts, but we're going to do away with them? Why would he say, seek earnestly the best gifts, and yet I'm going to show you a better way, forget about the gifts, go this way? Seek earnestly the best gifts, yet show I unto you a more excellent way. Operate the gifts of the Spirit in the love of God. That's the context of the scripture. Operate the gifts of the Spirit in the context of love. We must love each other. We must serve each other. We must be humble towards each other. But when we face the devil head on, when we eyeball the devil, we don't honor him. We don't listen to him. We have no time for him. So when we eyeball the devil face on, we are as bold as a lion of the tribe of Judah. Humble towards each other, but bold as a lion when it comes against the devil and his hellish doctrines that has hundred this land, this nation, this world for years. There's a scripture in Isaiah, and I haven't found it, but I will find it, for I know it's there. There'll come a day whenever they look upon that old serpent, the Lucifer, Satan, whatever you want to call him, and they're going to say, is this he that deceived the whole world? Is this he that deceived the whole world? But we're going to fix our eyes upon the Lord. And time is gone, but we'll continue on at another time. What I've been talking about here today, if you've been watching online, this is for the truly born again, blood-washed people. The baptism of the Holy Spirit is for the Church of Christ. Today as well as yesterday, until the church is removed, the gifts of the Holy Spirit are in the church and will be operated in the church. But if you're not born again of the Spirit of God, you're not in the church. And we have proved from the Word of God that the world cannot receive the Holy Spirit. And the dividing line between the world and the church has been born again of the Spirit of God, washed in the precious blood of Jesus. Not infant baptism, not confirmation, not first communion, not any religious ritual, but an act of repentance and call upon the name of Jesus. And if you're watching today and you're not saved and you want to get to heaven, Jesus Christ said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. No man can come unto the Father but by me. The only way you're going to get to heaven is through repentance and calling upon the name of Jesus. So if you're at that place where you want to give your life to the Lord, repeat this prayer after me. Lord Jesus Christ, I repent of my sin. I turn away from my sin. I turn away from idolatry. I turn away from hellish doctrines. I put my trust fully in you. And I believe in my heart and I confess with my mouth that you are the Son of God. You are the Savior. You are the healer. You are the baptizer and the Holy Ghost and fire. You are the King, the coming King. And I give my life to you today. Come in and take my life. Come in and rule and reign in my life. If you have prayed that prayer today, you have been born again of the Spirit of God. Find a Bible-teaching, Bible-believing church and turn on to the Lord. If you have prayed that prayer, I want to pray with you right now. Father God, I thank you for those that have called upon the name of Jesus. I praise you, Lord, for those that have given their life to you today. And Father God, I pray that the fire of God will come on them from head to toe. Lord, if they've got a physical healing need today, I pray physical healing burn through them from head to toe. I pray, Father God, that you will heal them. You will baptize them in the Holy Ghost and fire with the Bible evidence of speaking in tongues. And I pray, Father God, that they will grow and develop in you. Oh, hallelujah, Lord, I give you all the praise. I give you all the glory. I pray for their financial needs today. Lord, I praise you that you supply all our needs according to your riches and glory through Christ Jesus. So, Father God, I pray, draw them unto yourself. And Father, I pray for this people here today. I praise you for each and every one of them. Lord, I praise you, Lord, for the dead, every one of us give our lives to you. And Father, I ask you, Lord, to touch each and every one today. Lord, you know every desire. You know every need. I pray, Father God, in Jesus' name, grant every need, every desire today, in Jesus' name. And Father, as we leave this place, we know we won't leave you behind, but you will go with each and every one of us. And Father God, I pray, keep and protect us. Lord, we apply the precious blood of Jesus around the borders of our inheritance in Jesus' name. And Father God, we'll be very careful. Give you all the praise and give you all the glory. And God's people said amen, amen. And shouted hallelujah. Hallelujah, amen, praise God. May the Lord bless each and every one.